Home Studio Tutor, the podcast. For independent home recording engineers, music producers, and entrepreneurs. Motivation, inspiration, and education. Home Studio Tutor, the podcast. Let your transformation begin.
Welcome to Home Studio Tutor. We're pleased that you could make it here today, where our mission is to take time and talk about the journey of the home studio owner, home recording artists, and independent artists who are thinking about a career in the independent music business. We have a very exciting guest today. Our guest today, Alex Rome, is an EDM producer who does it for a living. He's doing it full time. And again, that's the whole point of Home Studio Tutor, to talk about how can we perfect our craft? How can we take it to the level that we can do what we love to do for a living? Welcome, Alex. How you doing?
Doing well. Thanks for having me here.
Of course, man. It's a pleasure, man. So I started hearing about you before we even talked about bringing you on to the podcast. Yeah, absolutely. And I heard there's this EDM producer who's doing great things. He's doing his thing for a living. And I said, wow, man, I got to really check this guy out and see what's happening, man. So we'll get into that a little bit. But why don't you start by just telling us all a little bit about yourself, man, and what you're doing musically and all that good stuff.
So, yeah, what I do is pretty simple. I try to help producers reach their music production goals through courses, private one-on-one lessons, and I do little group sessions as well. And I find my producers and students through YouTube and Instagram and all just social media marketing. And lately it's been really, like, I've been blessed with so many students and opportunities to really grow, and it's just been amazing. But yeah, that's what I do. I just make music and teach how to make it all day, every day.
So you're literally living the dream.
It's the dream. Yeah,
it's the great dream. So how long have you been producing?
So I've been producing now for 8 years. I started, like I said, when I was 19. I started making hip hop beats on the little MK2 drum pads from Native Instruments, and Machine was actually my first DAW. But I didn't like Machine, so I quickly ventured off of that and I got into Logic because it was the easiest one to get for free.
Right.
Back in that day.
Shh.
Yeah.
Not anymore, right?
Yeah, not anymore. But all right. That's how I started in Logic. And when I switched to Logic, it was like 4 months after I started making music. And just every day since then, I'm 26 now, all day, every day. My goal has been like just make the best music possible. And I've been just searching for ways to really to take like the best workflows that I've learned from my experience doing it and make it like pretty much make it content and make it put it into words and pass that on to other people.
That's fantastic, man. So you started when you were 19 years old, you're 26 now. Right. How did you develop your chops, man? Because you're talking about 7 years and you obviously had to go from knowing absolutely nothing to the point where now you're actually teaching folks and making a living out of it. How did you build up that skill set?
The best way to learn, and like I live by this, it's just to do it every single day, even through the times when it sucks sometimes. Sometimes a new artist could come out. Like, this is something that always would knock me down. Like, I discover a new artist who's killing it and they have a sound that is so far out of this world. And it's so much more amazing than where you thought the threshold of entry was. Like, so sometimes I would think I would know everything and then I'd see a new artist and I'm like, oh, I don't know anything. Like, if he's doing that. And like, so that would happen a lot. You just, you have to just keep doing it and like keep doing it as often as possible. Like, I've taught so many people who have full-time jobs or, you know, they have very, very busy lives and busy schedules, but work ethic and practice like doesn't discriminate. Like I've seen some people with the busiest schedules accomplish the craziest things and be able to, you know, shift from a busy, I don't know, like school teacher into a full-time musician by just staying motivated and never give up. Just don't give up. That's everything.
Yeah, I mean, that's a good point. And I think it's almost become cliche where, you know, we can let people know, hey, you just got to do it every day. You got to do it all the time. It's right. Become so cliche that I think a lot of people let it go in one ear and out the other.
Yeah.
But you're absolutely right. It's about those 10,000 hours.
Yes. I totally I'm all for that 10,000 hour rule. I totally believe it. And when I see it, like I've seen it in person happen with so many people. Like, it just concrete. It's just concrete. Like, you need to get as many hours as possible.
Yeah, you really do. Especially nowadays. You know, we all have our cell phones in our hands. I don't know how many hours a day we're spending. What, an hour on YouTube and, you know, right. An hour on Instagram, and we're on Netflix and we're doing all right. These things. And sometimes it's about just kind of managing your time.
Really?
You know, you want to make a career in music. You want to move into production, engineering, mm-hmm. opening a studio. You're absolutely right. You have to put the time in, man.
Right.
So you are an EDM producer.
Yes.
So what was it about EDM that led you that direction? Because I noticed you said at first you were producing hip hop.
Yeah. So I like producing everything, but when I was producing hip hop beats in the beginning, I'm very introverted.
Mm.
And like, I kind of built my life around my introvertedness. Mm. So as a hip hop producer, I didn't have any artists that I could like link up with, because it seems like the guys who were able to make content and or make moves in the industry, they all had like all these artists would have their producer that they were cool with. But when I realized like I wasn't gonna go out and meet anybody in the industry, because I don't move like that. I looked at EDM and I was like, well, I still like the sound of it, and I could be introverted and produce that kind of music by myself. So that's why I did it, is because it was easier and I liked it. And I looked at the market had just exploded at that point, because it was around 2011, 2012 when, Avicii was popping up. Martin Garrix was super young and popping up. All these young artists were exploding. And I thought it would be a good time to get into the market, because it was so big and popular that if I had just started and not given up, I would have been able to make my way in there. Where hip hop, my barrier to entry would be like, I have to go network some, and then I'd have to, I still wasn't like as comfortable with that industry. I liked hip hop beats, but I wasn't as familiar with hip hop as I was electronic and pop and stuff like that.
Got it. So when you look at EDM, what would you say are some of the formulas to the music? You know, so if I think about a hip hop beat, right, I'm breaking everything down into bars. You might have 8-bar choruses, maybe 16-bar verses, that type of nature. When I hear EDM personally, I hear so many buildups and drops right. And all these things going on. What would you say are just some of the keys to EDM production?
Just narrow it down to the core fundamentals.
Mm-hmm.
Like, everything, doesn't matter how hard it is, how complicated it is, everything has a core fundamental. It has, like, EDM, although there's a lot going on, there still is the core melodic structure. There's still the core composition. There's the core fundamental drum line. It's all still there. The hardest thing to wrap your head around as somebody who's not in the industry or somebody who's new at it is, all the crazy sounds that are going on. Like, you hear the craziest fancy synths, the craziest fancy effects. Every transition has a crazy transition sound. There's those rising synths before the drops. Right. There's sweeps. There's this. There's that. So it's very hard to pay attention to the core, like what it is at its base.
Right.
But it really is, like, if you can look at it as simple as possible and get good at those fundamentals, that's, you will skyrocket your ability. Because I think what happens is, like, some people, like, some students get into it and they start focusing on things that don't matter, like mixing and mastering, and then they start trying to make the coolest sound, which cool sounds are important, but it is still music. Mm-hmm. So you have to learn how to write a song. And when you can compose a nice song, you can then dress it up in fancy synths and dress it up with all the other effects. And yeah, that's the key that I think you would have to really do to get good at EDM.
Okay. That's great advice, man. Now, you were producing EDM. Obviously, you got started. What were some of your initial goals in EDM? Because I know ultimately what you're doing now, you started teaching, and that really has allowed you to do this full time. But sure. But like, what was your trajectory as a producer of EDM?
My trajectory was always to make money at it, like figure out how to make money at it, and I'll be all right. And when I had first started, I had internet marketing skills, and I had this idea of how I would use them after I got good. My first goal was to start performing it, and then I would build up my DJ name. I wanted to be like a big DJ. And then I started performing it, and it just wasn't half as fun to me as sitting behind my computer and just making songs all day. So I didn't like performing it. I stopped performing it. And then I went into looking at other avenues. Okay, so like, what can I do if all I want to do is make music? I started ghost producing it, and that was my main source of income. And then I started mixing it for other people. And I got super far into that. And then ghost production, like, ghost producing was cool in the beginning, because, yeah, I felt really good at what I did. But then as you do it, it starts kind of like biting back at you. Like, people start getting bigger like a year later on a song that you produced for them.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Or you can go to, I went to a show one time, and like a big show, Ultra Music Festival, and I was in the crowd, and gotcha. So I was in the crowd at Ultra Music Festival, and one of the, it was a smaller DJ, but he was playing one of the songs that I had ghost produced. That was like a real wake up call. Like, I did not like that. I was in the crowd, like, listening to this song that I had ghost produced, and I was contracted not to say anything. Like, 'cause you signed really nasty contracts as a ghost producer. And I learned a lot about ghost producing, but that was like my wake up call. Like, okay, I made this song, and I'm gonna grow nothing with this. Like, right. My song made it here, but I get nothing.
Mm-hmm.
So I still needed to grow, and I figured I was still teaching it at the time, but if I actually doubled down on teaching, I'd get more gratification out of helping more people reach their goals. And that, to me, like, 'cause there's no contract there, I get to actually help them grow. And so I get to see my work affect them positively, and, you know, I get to grow with them.
Right.
So that's, if that all makes sense.
Absolutely. So when you say ghost producing, for those out there that aren't familiar with it, what is ghost producing?
Ghost producing got really, really hot with electronic music because, I guess it's because there's no vocal involved. It's not really like a, it wasn't really a vocal genre when it blew up. So all that this person needed, what, like, it, let's take Diplo. All Diplo needs to perform a set at Ultra Music Festival, EDC, or wherever, is a track list of songs that he created. And so what happened really, I guess, early on in the industry is the DJs figured out that if they hired somebody to make their song and nobody knew about that person, that they could spend more time touring and making all their money touring, and while somebody's in the background making all their songs for them. And that's a ghost producer, is the person who produces their songs for a DJ who is performing them. And nobody is supposed to know about the ghost producer, and the DJ just puts his names on the tracks, and
right,
the ghost producer just gets their fee, and yeah.
So you're technically then a work for hire. And so that work for hire, you sign the contract. So you basically are the employee.
You are.
And so you turn that music over. And so that person who, quote unquote, hired you, now they are technically the new author of that music. So they actually can copyright it and do everything else. And so you lose all your rights to it after that work for hire,
you
correct?
Lose all the rights.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's something to keep in mind. And so would you do that again?
Never in my life.
No.
No, it's funny, like, when I was doing it, I hated it so much that I would just keep hiking the price up higher of my songs. And I've had this mindset, like, okay, well, if someone's paying me, I don't know, $2,000, $3,000, $4,000 for a track, $5,000 for a track, I'll feel better about it. Mm-hmm. But, like, when I did that and people were still paying that price, I was equally as bummed out about that track. It's harder to work on a track like that too. It takes the magic out of that. And and another thing is, like, when people request a track from you, they cannot put into words what they want to hear what kind of song they want from you. They give you keywords, you try to build a song based on those keywords, and 9 times out of 10 you're just going to get the track returned like 15 times until it's exactly what they heard in their head.
Right.
So it's hard work.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. You know, you said something earlier that was really interesting, because you said you're an introvert.
Right.
By heart. I'm also an introvert. And nice. You know what's interesting? Some of the most successful people financially and in terms of building brands are introverts.
Right.
When you think about Elon Musk, when you think about Steve Jobs, when you think about the founder of Facebook, you think about Warren Buffett, they're introverts. And I think that in terms of what we do, you know, we are music-based folks who live in our creative world. Right. And a lot of folks who are in their home studios making beats, recording folks, they do tend to be introverts. A lot of times they're not getting out. They're not doing a ton of networking. Right. But it's great to see and to know that folks can still be extremely successful no matter what. And I think this is the age of the introvert.
No, it is. The internet gives us our voice.
Yes, it does.
It gives us our power. Like, you don't have to leave your house to really reach anybody anymore.
That's so right. And you can be great at what you do. You obviously have to have a plan. So when we talk about you moving into teaching, like, you already talked about what led you to that, but what was your plan? How'd you set that up and kind of get moving with that?
Oh, this is where it, like, gets weird. So I when I started teaching, it was like, I was at this point, like, I was 3 years into the music thing, I think, I don't know, around there. I was actually in my grandparents' basement, like, as I was, I don't know, 23 years old, around there, 22, 23. I had no money. Like, I'd stopped ghost producing, wasn't getting paid anything from that anymore. So I was kind of making money doing, like, a one-on-one lesson here and there. I wasn't really marketing it. So, like, people were just asking for them, and I would do them for, like, $25. And I started taking lessons when I was in my grandparents' basement. And That's like I was in college at the time too. So that's like a key factor too. So I was in college, living at my grandparents, doing YouTube videos to get traffic, to turn into lesson money. And that's how that started. I was like, okay, well, I want to grow this because I enjoy this.
Right.
I could do this. I could teach people one-on-one. And I still really like, it took me like that whole year. I only sold like a couple of lessons a month. And I was having a really hard time getting that one off the ground, like a seriously hard time. And I figured like what I would do is I would get out of my grandparents' house and go into a really cheap apartment, but it would drive me to figure out how to pay rent.
Mm-hmm.
So I moved into a $700 a month apartment when I was making about $700 a month.
Okay.
So, I moved into that apartment and it was, oh my God, it was just so scary. I managed to make rent every month for the next few months. So it was doable, but it was very like paycheck to paycheck. It was like in a month, I would do like $700. It'd go up to like $1,200 at the time. And I was kind of stuck there at that monthly rate. The next year didn't really change. But I was hitting new highs, like $2,000 a month or something. And I think I was 24 at this point, 24. Yeah, 24. And I was in college, my last year of college. So it was the beginning of my last year of college. And I was in college for marketing. And I was sitting in class really like stressing out about paying rent.
Mm-hmm.
And college was really the main thing taking away from all the time I wanted to put into my business and music.
Mm-hmm.
And because of college, I couldn't put all the time I wanted. I couldn't feel comfortable. So I was really stressed out in class. I was listening to the professor talk. And I was like, you know what? Like, I think I just got up midway through this class. And I decided right there, like with the stress on me, I was like, I could stop going here and I'll be able to make rent easier. Or I can stay here, risk missing rent, and if I stay here, there's a good chance I won't be able to take up music because I'll have a degree and I'll just do the easier thing if I get a degree, which is just get a job that I don't want. So I dropped out of college on that spot, went home and worked rigorously to get to where I wanted to go. I got a mentor, which I never had. And after I met my mentor, he's a super remarkable guy. Who had made amazing accomplishments in the tech business world and like Silicon Valley. He was an amazing guy.
Right.
I met him and was able to skyrocket my business to a point where it's just so fun and I don't have to worry about money anymore. Well, like I do, but like it's not that big of a deal anymore. Like it's my business is in a good place. I have traffic. I can make music. Now I have more time to spend making music and really figure out now what I want to do with music as a musician. I have students, like so many students. It's like life is crazy. And I'm just happy I never stopped.
Yeah, man. That's very motivational, man. So if someone wanted to take your classes, how would they go about that?
If somebody wanted to learn from me, I would say just start watching my YouTube videos, my latest YouTube videos, and really get an idea for how I learn or how I teach.
Right.
And because my online course, it's called the EDM Bootcamp. It's a 6-week structured course that you can do at your own pace. And some of the packages come with my own help. In the form of Skype sessions, one-on-one Skype sessions. And if that sounds interesting to you, I always say just watch some of my YouTube videos, get a sense for how I teach, get a sense for what I teach and how I talk. And if you like it, then I usually pitch them at pitch the boot camp at the end of every video. And okay. There's a link in my description. Click on the link and read you all you want about it.
Awesome. So that's the EDM boot camp.
Yes.
It's a 6-week structured course. Now, what is your YouTube channel called?
My YouTube channel is called Alex Rome.
Alex Rome. Yeah. Okay. Well, Alex, it's been a pleasure to meet with you today.
This has been awesome.
It's right on time, man. Our whole focus at Home Studio Tutor is to educate, to inspire, and to guide. And you definitely did that.
That's awesome.
And like I always say, man, you can show somebody exactly what you do and they'll make a great sounding record. You teach them how to do it, they'll have a great career.
Yeah, that's right.
Yes, sir,
like that.
Man. Hey, man, appreciate
it, man. Thanks so much for having me on.
Oh, and finally, where can they find you on Instagram and all that good stuff?
Instagram is at AlexRomeSound.
Right.
Website, alexromesound.com, and then YouTube/AlexRome.
Alex Rome. And always check us out on Home Studio Tutor. And we will see you next time around.